So what is TED? I got an invitation 4 years ago, an email, said, we'd like you to give a TED talk. I was surprised. I didn't know United Airlines invited people to give talks. I thought I'd get some frequent flyer mileage out of it. And as I read further, it turned out the invitation was from a woman named June Cohen, who's the associate director, and I remembered she was a former student of mine at Stanford in the 1980s. And so she described what TED is. And TED is an acronym for, it's not United Airlines, United Airlines. It's technology, entertainment, and design. And it's not actually clear where psychology fits. I guess somewhere a little bit each of those things. If we think of education as we entertain while we educate, and we use a lot of technology, and we design great classes and great research. But it's a riveting, it's riveting talks by remarkable people, free to the world. And they hold a national conference every year in Long Beach, California since 1990. But your key to fame is organizing what's called a TEDx conference. You can do it, anybody can do it. You can do it in your school, high school, colleges, in your businesses. And you go to TED.com and they show you how to do it. And then you give a great talk following the guidelines I'm going to give you today. Then you send that video in and you get people to nominate you, and that's how you get on the big TED stage. It's very difficult to be invited to go there on your own, and it's also difficult just to attend. It costs $7,500 registration for 4 days, but of course you get free lunch, okay? So how do you do it? How are you going to do it? And there are two secrets. One secret's about your content, and one secret's about your delivery. So secrets of content. Have a big idea, one big idea, that is worth sharing with the general public. And you're going to present it in an elegant way. So again, for me, my audience has always been my mother, who was uneducated. That's the public. And if she understands it, then my Psych 1 students will understand it. If they understand it, then my colleagues will understand it. Have a personal story. This is true for teaching, that you should teach narratives. Have a story that somewhere in your talk you're going to talk about, you know, you're going to relate yourself, your personal self, to your audience. And especially in teaching, students really love that. Have a revelation. During the course of your presentation, there's some small thing that you're going to reveal, not like Cindy Gallup necessarily, that has a big impact. Again, like Dan Ariely. Here's a small thing about perceptual illusions, which leads us to understand how we have to change the form on the DMV if we want to get people to be willing to donate their organs. In some cases, in your talk, you lead the audience or your students toward one possible conclusion, and then you flip it. Just when they expect this is where you're going to go, you flip it. And that's what people, it becomes memorable. And again, it's really important to give novel examples, examples that are not tried and true. The key, again, in all of this is never make your talk information dense. And this is really true of introductory psych. I learned this after many, many years. You should have, at most, three ideas that you present. I think in introductory psych, you should have one idea. If you give a full course, which is maybe 20 or 30 lectures, if students remember 20 or 30 ideas, one from each lecture, that's an enormous amount. We typically try to give too much information, especially I do, as you could see in my first talk, it was just too much information. And so you really want to decide when you lay out the whole talk, is this really essential? You know, what is the most important thing? When they walk out and you say, hey, what did you learn? Or if you listen in the elevator, when somebody hears your talk, a student or TEDster telling somebody else, hey, what was that all about? You would like them to get the one sentence that is the core of your talk accurately. But now, as you saw, the key is not just content. And this is where psychologists fall down. We get no training in how to teach. There's very few programs that ever help teaching assistants teach. I was alarmed when I visited Ohio State recently, where they have oh, I don't know, 4,000 or 5,000 students take introductory psych, and they're almost all taught by graduate students. And graduate students come in having just graduated from an undergraduate program, and they're given two classes to teach, and there's no training in how to teach. Some do it well, some do it poorly. So again, it's learning how to deliver your message. What TED has done, it's changed the time frame of lectures. In the past, lectures have been based on academic time, which is 50 minutes to an hour. The TED model is nothing ever takes more than 20 minutes. And so all talks now in almost all conferences are between 12 and 20 minutes. I've been talks now around the world, different conferences, and there's now this upper limit. 20 is the upper limit, usually it's 18, 15, 12, and sometimes 10. And what you have to do is practice, 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 practice. And whatever the limit they tell you is be able to come in shorter. Because when you're actually doing it, you're going to remember some little tidbit that you want to work in, and that's going to take 30 seconds or a minute. And you want to have a pace. You want to have a smooth pace. And that's the kind of thing, I think, of the presentation. That's why I like Brian Stevenson. He's getting a lot of information across, but there's a steady pace. He's leading you along. It's as if he's carrying you along. And you want it to be smooth, but essentially you want to convey energy, passion through high energy. You have to really care about what you're saying. So that's the passion. When you're up there, the audience feels that person would rather not be doing anything in the world other than being there, sharing his or her ideas with you. You gotta use humor. Not there was a joke, let me tell you about the thing. But again, all the things you saw that once the audience laughed, it broke the disconnect, the physical disconnect. And also I heard you, when you laughed when they laughed. So think about how to engage the audience through a little bit of humor from now. Tony Robbins did it to excess. But one of the problems we have is we teach at a lectern. We're fixed. That means the audience is fixed on you, and they habituate to you, and you begin to be dull. So you have to move around. And I think this is a thing that women tend not to do at all, women teachers. If you're on a stage, you are a performer. That is your role. And when you go from teaching a seminar or a small class to being on the stage, you have to break the set. People expect you to be a performer. That's what you do on a stage. And so you have to own the stage. You have to feel that this is my place. This is my space. Hand gestures are important, okay? I'm Sicilian. We live with hand gestures. So again, practice gestures so that they're smooth. And again, what I liked about Brian Stevenson, they were very small. One, he's making three points. This, this, and this. And so the audience is following. You're punctuating, you're underlining those key points. And lastly is, we grow up now in a visual world. Your students now live in a visual world, watching television, on internet, Facebook, et cetera, watching these kinds of videos. You cannot give a lecture without visuals. The two kinds of, so the visual clips, which you should have, you should develop, and there's tons of them you can get on YouTube and so forth. You should never use PowerPoint, you should use Keynote. If that means buying a Mac, make that investment. What Keynote does is it has many special transitions, many special features, but most important, as you saw here, you can embed videos that when you click, it treats it as if it was a slide. It appears and then disappears. And PowerPoint doesn't allow you to do that. There's now a new presentation device called Prezi, which you should take the time to learn. Prezi it bridges the visual landscape between whiteboards and slides. PowerPoint and Keynote are really developments of the old carousel slide projector. With Prezi, it's a canvas. It's a whiteboard. So imagine, you say, what are you going to put in your talk? Well, there's this video, this key point. And essentially, what Prezi does is it allows you to use your visual imagination. So for example, if you're giving a talk on psychology, what is psychology? That would be your opening scene, and then you click in the one box, and here's an interview some kid is talking about what he learned in introductory psych, and then you can click on that, and you can zoom in to the chart behind him, then you can zoom out and go to the next thing. It allows you total freedom. And it's really very, very dynamic. So I would encourage you to learn Prezi, It's just, I guess we went back. It's Prezi.com. Now, there are two TED Talks, and I'm almost finished. One, as I said, is for the audience. The other talk is for the internet audience. And ultimately, that's the important one. Did you notice something about each of those talks that's different from all the talks that universities have? And many of them are failing. Most talks are a talking head. There's a single camera, and the speaker's speaking, usually at a podium, looking up to notes and even showing things. In the TED Talks, there are three video teams. One is circling around the speaker, one is on the audience, and one is on the slides. And so at the end of an 18-minute talk, you have three 18-minute segments, and they turn it over to a post-production video team, in this case, headed now by Michael Glass and previously by Jason Wishnow, my students at Stanford, previous students at Stanford. And they spend on each talk 6 to 20 hours. So it makes the talks dramatic, and when they do it really well, you don't even notice. It's close-up of you, the audience from behind you, so on the audience, on a slide. And so it creates a dramatic drama. So there's an article in New Yorker just recently about TED, and the cute thing was a speaker videographer interplay. So I'll try to read these. So it says, aha moment in T minus 4 seconds. Leg position, move like this. So this is as if the videographer is telling the actor what to do. Tilt your head 12 degrees. Now crocodile tears. Lastly, emotion, exorbitant disdain to placid contemplation. Remember to press the button to move to the next slide. So essentially, you are an actor on a stage, and this is making fun of it, of course, saying we're going to program in these kinds of things. With that, I want to say go forth and just do it. Do it good, do it right, but most importantly, have fun doing it.